Good afternoon. Welcome everyone to the fifth annual SABR Analytics Conference. I'm Mark Appelman, I'm the CEO of SABR, and we have a very exciting conference in store for you. From now on, everything will actually be in this room, except for the two lunches on Friday and Saturday, which are up on the second floor, and the welcome reception, which will be on the third floor this evening. But everything else is in this room, all the panel speakers and research presentations. And just to run through quickly today's schedule, after I introduce the conference and Vince Gennaro comes up, the president of the board, to talk a little bit and introduce Brian Kenny. Brian is going to give a talk called Ahead of the Curve, and then we'll have a brief break and we'll have an analytics of hitting and pitching panel, and that'll feature Aaron Boone, Dallas Braden, Eno Saris, and that'll be moderated by Mike Farron. And following that, we will have two research presentations, back-to-back, a half hour each. Those will also be in this room, Jason Sherwin and Scott Spratt. Then we'll have a 15-minute break, and right up here will be the MLB Now panel, hosted by Brian Kenny. We'll have a brief break, and from 7 to 9:30 upstairs, we will have the welcome reception, networking reception, and I don't think Springsteen's going to go on at exactly 7, so if you want to come for at least a few minutes and have a drink and say hello, it's only a few blocks away, you'll get to the concert in time, because I think a good part of this conference is going to see Springsteen tonight. One of the things we do with the Analytics Conference is, thanks to Tony Yoseloff and the Yoseloff Foundation, Tony sponsors four students between the ages of 18 and 29 to come to the conference, and all their expenses and registration are paid through that. We do something on our website where applicants send in essays, and then they're judged, and we pick four winners each year. And the four winners are sitting over here. If you would stand, and I'll introduce. We have Andrew Lastman from SMU, Julia Meyer from Augustana College, Jan Ramos from USC, and Taryn Sharmer from Duke. And if everyone can give them a warm welcome. This year, like we did last year, instead of having questions being asked by a microphone, we're going to have everybody write their questions on cards in the back, and then the questions will be brought up to the speakers and moderators afterwards. We just find that's a little bit quicker and more efficient way to do it. So right on the back table there are pens and cards. If you just want to write your questions there, then they'll be brought up. And I think from now on, I just want to introduce Vince Gennaro. Vince is the president of the SABR board, among many other things. I'll let him introduce himself, and then he'll introduce Brian.
Well, thanks, Mark. And it's great to look out over the crowd and see another nice and terrific audience here today. And, you know, when Mark and I conceived this conference a little over 5 years ago now, the thought was to bring the thought leaders together, the baseball analytics community, to debate and discuss what's going on in the industry, the state of the art of technology, of new data, and really understand the way the industry is moving forward and moving rapidly into this area. It's been around for 40 years, but it's actually accelerating at a clip that is really uncanny in terms of the amount of information. In fact, I was doing some analysis recently on the amount of data, and by my calculation, in 2015, when StatCast debuted for every game, it was piloted in a number of locations before that, the amount of data that we're capturing in 2015 per game is, if my math is correct, 1.3 million times more than we were collecting in 2005. So we're talking about, in a 10-year time frame, 1.3 million times more information is generated. Now, not all that information is going to be useful or highly useful. In fact, that turns the tables a lot. It used to be, in this business and in a lot of businesses, it used to be the more data you could get your hands on, the higher the likelihood was that you were going to do something good with it and make a more informed decision. Today, we're at a point where the ability to screen out the useless data or the data that has less value is really where we're finding the winners in terms of data analytics. So I'm glad we're having this conference at this point in time because we're doing it every year because there's always so much new information and the changing landscape to really digest and understand. So now what I'd like to do is introduce our first speaker today, and it's Brian Kenny. Brian has had a long career in sports broadcasting and in the media. He had a long career with ESPN before he joined MLB Network. He's been the leading voice for baseball analytics in the media. I don't think anyone could challenge that title of his. And at ESPN, he won an Emmy for Baseball Tonight. And he was also a key member of that SportsCenter team. But here at MLB Network, where he is now, he really is pioneered a new show in terms of Clubhouse Confidential, and also the descendant of Clubhouse Confidential, which is MLB Now. And he's really brought analytics into the mainstream, given it the kind of credibility, and made it part of the everyday vernacular. And part of that is because he's able to have a dialogue with people who played the game on air, coming from a different vantage point, and have that give and take. Actually, maybe it's sometimes a little more give and a little less take, but it's a give and take. And he's also one of the leading boxing announcers. I don't know if that many of you know that, but he is one of the leading boxing announcers in the game. And he also was once named the Sports Illustrated Media Personality of the Year. So there's really no other person that would be better to kick off the fifth annual SABR Analytics Conference than Brian Kenny. Brian?
Vince, thank you very much. Hi, everybody. Welcome aboard. I'm honored to be asked to speak here and to be able to talk to all of you. And something that Vince said really stands out. And it just think about the power of this room, the power of some of the founding fathers of the Society of American Baseball Research, and what is happening now in its total immersion. I didn't jump out to be like some sort of sabermetric proselytizer. I didn't try to jump out and say, I'm going to be the champion of analytics. I just, from the early days, started reading a lot of what was being written by a lot of people here. And I saw the logic in it. And because I was in the media talking baseball hour after hour after hour, constantly giving quantifiable information, which is what you do when you're doing highlights, when you're doing discussions, I just thought I'd go with the best information. And I found myself very much alone in that for many years in the mainstream media. And I kept turning around and saying, where is everybody? And even now, years and years later, it's just coming up. And it's coming up from the undercurrent. And it is winning over the media, of course, eventually. But within the industry, it's happening at an exponential rate. It is actually on. It's happening. You know, the people who started the revolution here, it's totally taken over the game. It's amazing to me, and the speed with which it is, because even when I got to MLB Network, which was late 2011, which is recent history, even when I got there, it still felt like there was a lot of room to move. First of all, the reason I think I give more than I take is because there's a lot of back pay, you know, that I have to pay back for these guys for years, because the guys who have the jobs as analysts are former major league ball players, and they just haven't been immersed in this stuff. And I often say it's not their job to be immersed in analytics. It's not their job to understand grand strategy. They're the foot soldiers. It's their job to play and perform and produce. It's not their job. It's not their fault. When then they become the analysts, and you have now this other mainstream of analysts coming up from the Saber community at the same time, you could see what was what. And I was about the only one who was in both camps, living in this real world of television and mainstream media and sports writers and columnists, and also being totally entrenched in the sabermetric community and understanding what they were saying and just wondering, what's happening? Like, why can't we get good information? Why won't people accept good information? Now, I did write a book. It's coming out this July. One, I truly try to pay respect to the people here. I try to pay the proper respect. And part of the reason why I did write a book was I could see it all becoming part of the game, and I could see revisionist history already taking place. So for my small part, I tried to point out, no. These guys were saying it, and you were rejecting it for a long period of time. And I hold people accountable. Believe me, I try to be kind. When Ken Rosenthal is here later, I try to be kind to the sports writers, but I definitely take a bat to their knees. I mean, there's no question, they need to be held accountable, these guys. They hated on your stuff for so long, and I just couldn't stomach it as I sat there. Listen, I got into sports casting. I was a reporter, I was a broadcaster. I got into sports after I was a newscaster first, and I didn't see this path that I was going to take. And as I went along that path, I just saw a logical way of thinking that made sense to me. And I just couldn't, and maybe this is my own personal thing, I just couldn't stomach the nonsense, even on live TV. And even every day now, my producer, Micah Karg, is here now. And he says, well, there's the meeting room BK, and then there's the TV BK. The TV BK is even much nicer. Because in the room, I'm just thinking, oh, God, here we go again. Like, we're doing it again. It goes on and on. But we're seeing a total immersion at this point. And there was like really three areas still holding out. Some of the baseball teams, the managers, most all of them, and the media. And we've seen now, just like in the last year, and I'm doing this in broad strokes. I'm not saying these teams never used any analytics and they weren't smart. I'm not saying that. But we've seen Phillies, Reds, Brewers, Tigers suddenly go next level. Wherever they were on the path, you know what I'm saying, they jumped to another level. In the last year, these teams have stopped holding out and have just jumped in. As far as the managers, the last chapter in my book is actually called The Year of Getting Smart, and it was written last because it wasn't happening until I started writing the book. I wrote the book basically in 1 year. And my biggest concern at a certain point was that all these crazy, bold ideas I had would just be happening. You know, it was like, whoa, it's caught up to me. In 1 year, we're just gonna be doing these logical things, using competitive advantages, using the data, attacking things in the right way. And I thought, I would often say my son Peter was my research assistant. And I said to him, I said, look at this, look what Kevin Cash just did. Look what Jeff Bannister is saying. Look at, you know, AJ Hinch, look at what all these guys are doing. They're just smart, they're just doing it. And I was thinking, wow, by the time my book gets out and it's printed and it's finally put out, because books, as many of you know, written books, many books, takes a long time. It happens glacially. So I thought, by the time this book gets out, this stuff's just going to be done. I mean, think of what was done this year that took no criticism. You have to think about this. Joe Maddon, the whole year, had his pitcher batting eighth. Now, that's a small possible advantage. I'm not, you know, so bent on that. But okay, he did it, and what was said about it? Nothing, almost nothing. Maybe, you know, there'd be a note in a column for the first couple of weeks, a few sports writers would say something about it, and then after a while, and I think this is significant, it wasn't mocked. You know, the herd, I bring that up, that's my first chapter, the herd. I realize one of the big reasons we don't accept information is we are herd animals. We are very reticent to go outside of the herd, very much so. So all of these managers doing these small things and not facing ridicule, to me that's significant. Also, how often do you see a power hitter batting second now in the two spot? That never happened. 2004, when I saw the league championship series, I think that was Carlos Beltran, A-Rod, who was the other one that was batting? Larry Walker was the third one, and then it was, I think it was like Mark Bellhorn or someone for the Red Sox, who actually had a pretty good offensive year. But that's three powerhouse dudes batting in the two spot in the league championship series, three out of four. You remember that? And it was, and I thought at the time, I'm at ESPN, I thought, whoa, here we go. Now teams are getting it. Look at these stacked lineups. This is going to change. And it, but now it takes another 10 years for it to be immersed. And that's a common theme that I found in the research for my book was, you know, seeing all these things. Oh, the other thing that was thrown out there, bullpen games, Kevin Cash frequently using his closer in the eighth inning just because he had Big Poppy and company in the middle of the lineup coming up in the eighth inning. Why save him for the ninth? Yeah, it just makes sense. I thought, wow, all these things are happening. Managers, just this year, I think with the ushering of the old, like, powerhouse managers, a lot of the guys who had been here from the 70s and 80s, when those guys kind of moved out, and I'm not saying they're bad managers, a lot of them are Hall of Fame managers and were excellent, but they didn't have to be immersed in the new culture. As the new younger managers got in, and younger by, it can be 50, you know, Jeff Bannister's 50, but he's a young hotshot comparatively. He comes in and he's just thinking and he just wants to do things to win. And now when he does things like that, or he says, hey, you know what, we're not gonna have roles, we're not gonna do this and that. And I know he didn't act on all those things, but he has that mindset. And he, when he wasn't mocked for it, that's significant. The herd has changed. I asked Rob Nyer about that. I said, why did all managers get smart in 1 year? How did that happen? And he said, I don't think it's that. I think they all now, they're probably a bunch of smart ones, but now they have cover. You know, now they have cover. Now they know this, hey, even if they're going to get ripped by the local beat writer, which can still happen, there's still Fangraphs, there's Baseball Prospectus, there's other websites that will back him up. There's people writing about it. Fans are a little smarter about that. Things, you know, on social media will be, you know, snarky, but smarter about those sorts of things. So suddenly they're covered. Also, their owners, this is very important. Obviously, a lot of their owners are in the financial world, and they understand the application of data and the real connection between data and the physical world. So now they're covered, their bosses and the media, and now they can actually do it. So a lot of it isn't that they just got smart, it's a whole dynamic at play. But it took a long time. I mean, when I think about, this is something I only found out by studying for the book when I looked at the history of competitive advantage. Think about the three-point basket in basketball. Like, what's all the rage right now? Steph Curry, right? It's all bombing from three. Last year, Steph Curry took 11 three-pointers a game in the playoffs, took 11. In the first year, 1979 and 1980, the first year of the three-pointer, there was a guy by the name of, anybody? Downtown Freddie Brown. I mean, it was Downtown Freddie Brown, you know, downtown. He took two per game. That was year one, two per game. He was Downtown Freddie Brown. He led the NBA in three-point percentage. He was a bomber back then. In 1986, I think we have a good vision of that team, 86 Celtics, Larry Bird and Danny Ainge. In the NBA Finals, they made a total of 12 three-pointers. A total. The Warriors last year made a total of 67. So they weren't going far enough. They knew, hey, this is an advantage, shooting from three. I remember Chris Mullin when I was in college. I went to St. John's. And he was shooting from, you know, from deep, and we all thought, if there's a three-point line, and it came in shortly after that, like 87, 88, right around there, we all thought, oh, what would he score if he had a three-point line? But still, there's a reticence to really make a bold, bold step. It takes a while. I'll give you another one here. I'll give you another example. 1993, that's Michael Jordan's first NBA title. The Suns led the NBA with 398 threes. 398, number one in the NBA. 1993. Not like 1893, John Thorne. Not old, right? 1993. If they had hit 398 threes last year in 2015, they would have been dead last in the NBA. It takes a while. There's a lag time for excellence. I didn't even really put a finger on it. And I'm as stupid as anybody. I always call the live ball era. Let's do live ball records. Let's go from 1920, live ball era. I just parrot it. I say it constantly, live ball era. And then when I really did some research and realized the live ball came in 1909, I don't know why I never believed that, because I thought that baseball was kind of lying about it in certain places because they couldn't admit to when they jack up the ball. There's a long history of that. John Thorne is available after the meeting. He can tell you all about it. But it finally hit me only when I studied everything else that, wait a second, the live ball came into play in 1909. The live ball era started 1920. That did happen. There's a lag time. Everybody is still shooting, you know, hitting the daisy cutters, as I say, hit it low, hit it low, hit it low. No, only a few guys are uppercutting. Massive competitive advantage. For 11 years, the Yankees were still out-homering, like entire, you know, teams, like a good part of the leagues by 1927. They were still like, had a massive advantage. Even 7 years later, teams had not caught up to them. Think about this, the Boudreaux shift. Which is, and I was up in Cooperstown, I was at the Hall of Fame, and they have up on the wall, I know the Boudreaux shift, you all know the Ted Williams, Lou Boudreaux shift, of course, 1946, later used against Ted Williams in the 1946 World Series, and I'm standing there in Cooperstown, I look on the wall, and I go, oh my God, look at this shift, like that was not a half-hearted shift. There's only one guy on the left side of the field, not in the infield, he's in the left field, standing out there, one guy. I mean, the whole infield on that left side is wide, wide open. So that's 1946. If you read about the 1946 World Series, Ted Williams won World Series, the Cardinals just crushed him with the shift. This is like kind of broke his spirit, and he finally bunted, and it was lame, and it was awful. He hit 200 famously. You know, oh, he choked in the playoffs. He had, you know, obviously won World Series. It's ridiculous. But that shift harmed him. So what did teams do? They did not shift on Ted Williams. When did the shift really come into play? 2013? The live ball era is 1909, or live ball is 1909. Live ball era, 1920. Boudreaux shift, 1946. Defensive shifts, 2013. Relief ace, basically 1924. The Senators won a World Series with Firpo Marbury. 1924, firemen started to emerge in the late 40s. Like 20 years to catch up with that. Sabermetrics, in the 1980s, 1970s, 1980s. When did it really kick in? The 2000s. And it took a big book in 2003, and then the movie based on the book, you know, 8 years later. You know, when everyone's like, oh, wait a second. And I don't, in my book, by the way, I do throw in a lot, I talk to Michael Lewis, I throw in a lot on Moneyball, because Moneyball did definitely shoot this back through into the mainstream. But sabermetrics, you guys, again, I've read things where some people in this room and Bill James were tired about talking about walks and how undervalued they were by 1980. And still to this day, walks are undervalued and not properly understood. They are in the marketplace. Shin-Soo Chu got paid, but mostly it's still undervalued. We haven't caught up to it yet. Also, now what's the next thing? The high leverage bullpen attack, right? We see the three-headed monster of the Royals, and we see the Yankees getting three monsters themselves in the bullpen. And what that tells me, if I'm to back up and learn the lessons of my research, that's great, you're not going far enough. And I'm wondering, when is the first team going to be bullpenning? When are we going to see a bullpen attack? And I've figured that out. There's enough innings to go around. You can't do this. Well, you'd have to recondition people, but you could. But think about that. Like, how far are you going? Another example. You know, it's kind of the controversy of this offseason. Teams tanking. What are we going to do? And I was like, oh, yeah, makes sense. I'm pro-tanking. I think you should tank, basically, the way the rules are structured. Obviously, I've strong feeling for the Houston Astros and the way they went unabashedly into the sabermetric analytic era in just going whole hog. So I love that. So if you're going to tank, do it wholeheartedly in order to, of course, win. You're not trying to lose. You're trying to win eventually. But I just looked at the payrolls, and we were doing this on MLB Now last week, and I was like, all right, let me see the payrolls of some of these teams that are tanking. The Phillies are spending, have a payroll still of $100 million. Now, I know there's dead money on that, but that's where they're at. The Reds are at $90 million, and I know they tried to trade more of their guys, and they couldn't. The Brewers are at $60 million. The Astros' opening day payroll in 2013 was $18.8 million. Now that's tanking. you want to tank? You want to see tanking? We're going to tank. The Astros were tanking, and they did it so successfully. Other teams are, well, we should probably get into this too. And what does this tell me? You're not going far enough. You think you're tanking. You ain't tanking. That ain't tanking. We need some Astros tanking. If you really want to do it, do it. Now, it doesn't make sense for every team. Maybe some teams have a little, you know, core of players that they can build off of. But basically, if you're learning from these lessons, you realize you're not going far enough. You know, you wonder, like, why don't we take in good information? And why was there reticence for so long to listen to a lot of the people in this room? And I've wondered that, and with my study of it, I guess it comes down to two basic things. One, we are herd animals, and bucking the herd is something it's in our DNA. Bucking the herd is seen as dangerous, either within us and within the herd. Think about it in the animal kingdom. When you buck the herd, when you constantly go against the grain of the herd will kill you. It will physically kill you. Now, we don't physically kill you, but we'll ostracize you, marginalize you if you're thinking for your own, if you're thinking independently. You get these labels and these tags that continue to this day. And everybody pays lip service to thinking independently, but it's very, very difficult. We are herd animals. And as I spoke to people in various fields, I spoke to a nutritionist, an interview guru who worked with me at ESPN, who made a science of these things and figured things out and said, hey, why is it that people aren't taking this information? They all spoke to, there's a herd mentality. It's difficult to stray from the herd. And I got a quote, actually, when I found out how people think, like that we're not built for it and that we're herd animals. I saw a book, have you, anyone read Thinking Fast and Slow by Daniel Kahneman? It had some things in there that I think apply directly to baseball in a lot of ways. One, and I thought of this immediately, of sabermetrics, the most absurd notions and habits can survive when surrounded by a culture of like-minded community. Well, again, without you guys here in this room, most right here, without you guys here in this room crashing the party, they could have just gone on going triple crown RBIs and, you know, the cut of his jib. You know, why not? He has a good fail. He looked me right in the eye and he shook my hand and he shook it nice and firm, and I believe in that kid. Sure, that's great. What does he actually do? That might be more important. Here is another thing about, and this, all this you would think is written about baseball or baseball writers. This is about taking in new information, because I've tried to be receptive to new information in everything I've done and the way I've taken things in with baseball and other sports and try to keep an open mind on things. But why is it difficult? Because it is actually difficult for us. And this is, again, is from Daniel Kahneman, who was, won the Nobel Prize for his studies in this field. Again, the book is Thinking Fast and Slow. A general law of least effort applies to cognitive as well as physical exertion. It's actually difficult physically to think and think hard. It takes energy, it takes glucose. When you're doing your studies and you probably start munching out, that's your brain going, I need more. You actually want that, you need to get refilled. Goes on to say, the law asserts if there are several ways of achieving the same goal, people will eventually gravitate to the least demanding course of action. Laziness is built into our nature. So again, there was nothing that said the sabermetric revolution had to take place. I think without the computer, it probably doesn't take place. With the data that's coming out now, everything kind of reached a tipping point one after another, and now the dominoes are just laying out. As I said, it's happening fast. In 1 year, I thought, well, these crazy bold ideas, they're going to be passe, or they'll just be happening. But it did reach that tipping point. Laziness is built into our nature. No one wanted to hear it. Because my basic point, and I know this almost goes without saying, but again, Major League Baseball is extremely competitive. You're busting your ass all the time to get better and get wins and then make money because you're winning. So all these guys who are doing everything all the way up to putting hormones in their bodies to gain an advantage, how about getting some information to gain an advantage? Wouldn't we as human beings leap at that? Wouldn't we just be thirsty for that? Well, the people in this room, yes, but why most people aren't, I think is fascinating. A recurrent theme, this again from the economist Daniel Kahneman, many people are overconfident, prone to placing too much faith in their intuitions. They apparently find cognitive effort at least mildly unpleasant and avoid it as much as possible. Any sports writers here? Yeah, that's it. Narrative fallacies, there's more, I'll sneak this in before Ken Rosenthal arrives. Explanatory stories that, not that it's Ken, explanatory stories that people find compelling are simple. This relates to politics too. You know, simple, straight talk really appeals to us. Hey, things aren't so complicated. No, life is complicated. No, he just said it's everything's simple. There's our answers. We want things to be simple. People find it compelling things simple, concrete rather than abstract. Focus on a few striking events rather than the countless events that failed to happen. We humans constantly fool ourselves by constructing flimsy accounts of the past and believing they are true. Right, looking back and saying, well, it was, and it could be anything, and maybe this is true. Maybe it is contact for the Kansas City Royals. Maybe it's the three-headed monster. Maybe it's like everything and luck and random events and everything happening as well. Maybe they've found something. You know, every time a team wins, we latch onto something, and it's usually a narrative fallacy. As a lot of people, see Eno there, Fangraphs, right? I mean, the smart people write about this all the time. Not as sexy, right? Not as sexy to write that stuff, but that's actually what is happening. And you have gained a better understanding by knowing that. I will say this. Here's something else that I found, because I had a tendency just to bash sports writers and rip these guys. Here's something I found that really, really surprised me. I really thought, And this is why you do the research and it works out, because my thought, and this is where I'm guilty of it, I was looking to just back up what I thought by doing the study, right? Instead of, hey, let me ask a question and answer it, which is what Sabermetrics has taught me. I really thought that the MVP vote was just a botch job since 1931. I really thought, and probably ask you, how many would think that now? That they've just been botching this for decades, right? How many would think that this has been botching these votes forever? Yeah, I thought that too. I found actually, and I was kind, where I found a catcher, Roy Campanella, Yogi Berra, or Ernie Banks, I was kind in thinking, hey, wait a second, these guys are producing massive offense at defensive positions. I'm going to give them a pass. But I started in 1931, and I got to 1969, and I found 8 bad choices, egregious choices, 8. And then from 1987 to 1998, when I was paying attention, a lot of you were paying attention, they had 8 more in 12 years, right? So what happened? Like in the 70s, not so great. They had 4 bad votes from the 1970 to 1982. There were some bad votes. But from 87 to 98 is the golden era of botched sports writing comparative analysis. And that's what we remember best. We think these guys just botch it every year. And they don't, with the exception of Trout Cabrera and obviously that controversy. But that's not even so absurd when you're just looking at raw offensive production. I understand that, and yet I can disagree with it. But by and large now, these MVP votes are not egregious. They're not terrible. People are trying to weigh, between Andrew McCutchen and Buster Posey, well, it's catching. How much does that play into it? Hey, we have framing. We take that into account. There's a lot of things out there. So, right, there's no, some of these years, even Ryan Braun, Matt Kemp, I didn't think there was a bad answer that year. So we're not talking about that. We're talking about where do they just blow it, where they're just believing their own BS through the summer. 8 bad choices between 1931 and 1969. And you can go back to it. Hal Newhouser, Lefty Grove, oh man, 330 innings. Look at what they did, in their production. Wow, it made sense. One after another, I'm thinking, no, that's not that bad. No, that's not. Jim Constanti had led the league 1950. I thought, here's a perfect relief pitcher. The A's won the pennant. Of course, they're trying to give it to a Philly. There was no great power hitter on the team. Let's give it to the relief pitcher. He led the league in win probability added. He pitched 152 innings. He pitched, 74 games. So you can basically pick, that's half your games that you could win or lose that they applied this dude who led the league in ERA, who until the last week of the season had a 2.19 ERA in a high run scoring year. And I looked at Jim Constanti actually had a higher WPA than Robin Roberts, 150 innings versus 300. So properly applied, it made sense. And what were the sports writers really thinking then? I hope this doesn't collapse on me. I'm thinking that the sports writers were watching it, 1950, probably the guys who are voting are going to the games, watching the games. It's a smaller league, National League, that's all you're watching, the same teams over and over, and they probably just saw a lot of Jim Constanti and a lot of winning as a result of Jim Constanti putting out the fire and finishing up the last 3, 4, 5, 6 innings of the game. He did that a lot. So they got it right. And for I think that reason, I think a lot of the sports writers got it right based on that kind of, thing that we then think is a narrative fallacy, like Joe DiMaggio was, he just by arriving on the field, we felt confident and we went out and won for the Clipper. Okay, great. After a while, we laughed at that, but I don't know, what were we really looking at? What were they seeing? I think they were seeing something. I think they really were onto something. Somewhere along the way, maybe with expansion, games on TV, everything else, maybe refusing to see sabermetrics as well, and that's a big part of it. Maybe seeing that, maybe they then lost their connection And that's why in the 80s and 90s, you see these just terrible votes, all the way up to 2006 and Morneau and Sammy Sosa over Mark McGwire. That's been erased from our memories. We're not allowed to utter that, I think. That did not happen. The Summer of Love did not happen. But for whatever reason, the sports writers lost their connection and then didn't pick up the tools of comparative analysis. But the surprising thing to me was the old boys going out watching the games, right? That's what screamed to me all the time. Watch the games! Don't you watch the games? Well, I think there's something to watching the games, seeing it unfold when you really pay attention, and getting it correct. So I tried to give credit to the sports writers when they were getting it right, which includes 1941, DiMaggio over Ted Williams. That's in my book. You might not think that's possible. I got there. Wasn't trying to get there. I just got there. And with multiple examples throughout the year. So yeah, the book comes out in July. I'm hoping I don't tick too many people off. I tried to be kind. And again, I tried to pay, you know, the proper respect, Dick Kramer, Pete Palmer, John Thorne, John Dewan, Bill James, the pioneers from the Society of American Baseball Research, who were in a room, I'm sure, that was consisting of just them for many years. Again, congratulations to you. I can only say I'm old enough to have seen it all unfold in front of me and in front of the mainstream media, and I can only say, job well done. Congratulations, you've altered the thoughts of so many people in the right direction in thinking logically, and it all came about from the people within this small community and many of them in this room. So thank you and welcome. Are there any questions, or do we have questions? Does anyone want to answer, or do you want to bring up some things, or does anyone want to hold up their hand if we have them or not? Eno.
Do you have a worst
MVP? Yeah. I think the worst that I saw was, Cy Young is left and right because of wins and losses. I mean, there's no end to that. But MVP, like Justin Morneau was as bad as anything in history, like 2006. That was just, it was inexplicable. So that's one that stands out. And then the rest are kind of the usual suspects, George Bell, Andre Dawson. But I try to at least, if a guy is at least blowing people away with the power numbers that they thought were important, at least that makes sense. But a lot of them were missing that too. But any other questions? Yes. I didn't really see him. Did he go nerd? He went nerd? I don't know. I get, you know, guy his age has been raised in a different way. I almost put it akin to, because I've had many conversations with Goose, and he's a smart guy. And a lot of what he says about relief pitchers and the way he had his workload as opposed to the modern closer workload, he's right. I think if he got in a room with people, with some of us nerds, and we're actually just talking about it, he'd see we're all on the same page here. But beyond that, I didn't see exactly what ticked him off. Yes?
What do you make of John Henry saying we think we've gone too far with
him? That puzzled me. I was interviewed a bunch of times about that. To me, it looked like blame shifting. To me, if you, just by the use of sabermetrics, you could see what Hanley Ramirez was, you could see what Pablo Sandoval was, you could see what Rick Porcello was. So. And also, you know, again, from the teachings of a lot of people in the Sabre community, just in letting your team play, meaning here's our prospects, here's our blue chippers, they're going to be great. And unfortunately for them, three of them stunk in the same year. They finished in last place, and they said, oh, what do we do now? The answer is actually patience. Let Jackie Bradley play, and your guys will form your core. I think impatience is their real problem, not too much analysis. Yes? Oh, I started in 1931 to avoid that. Yeah, there was, before 1931, you could only win the MVP once. They would, imagine that. Imagine if we did that now. Oh, everybody gets a participation trophy. Ooh, you know, these are the 20s. They didn't care about that. But that was the actual rule. Yes? Well, I think we've reached that point now of where there's real buy-in from the teams. And now it's going to be, as Vince mentioned, what do teams do with it, and how do they attack it? And how do you find the information that's applicable? And it's probably going to be some sort of blend of things, of finding, like, what's the right size front office? I want to ask that of Dick Williams and Billy Epler when we have our GM meeting. Like, part of me thinks like I would hire every young kid in this room and just flood the zone, right? Just get a room full of people just studying things. But do you get so big that you can't act? Do you get so big as part of human nature is that we all will kind of, you know, get that regression to mediocrity, so we won't make decisions? Maybe you're better off being a rogue operative like Billy Bean, just saying, damn it, I'm going to do it, and he does it. I don't think there's going to be anything perfect, but I think we're seeing that things will be done in a logical way, and I think that will make it much more competitive. It's exploding, and soon, you know, there used to be much more knowledge in this room than with teams, and I think teams now, are, with all this information, they're going to have things and expertise that we're just not privy to. You know, their own proprietary databases that they're developing. Yes?
How much do you think the influx of money and the commercialization of the game with financial individuals going into the ownership slots has affected the matriculation of the SABR metrics into the mainstream?
Yeah, it's been huge. It's been huge. It took them a while to get there, though. You know, owners couldn't get past their managers for a long time. In fact, I tell a story in the book of being here at this conference, 2013, and it was a kid from the baseball ops department for a good team. They had really good players. They were a contending team. And I was talking about some of his players and bullpen utilization, lineup optimization, and he was telling me all these things that they were doing, and I was like, man, that's great. I was like, wow, because my first time I was really meeting all the kids, you know, I might have been 30-something years old, but the young guys, young women from the baseball ops departments. It was the first time I'd seen them. And then I had to say to the guy, you realize your team is not doing any of these things. And he said, yeah, that's not how it works. I was like, how is that not how it works? You've got all these smart people in the front office killing themselves, getting this stuff. You present it and you spit chaw on it or something. Like, get out of here, kid. You know, that has changed. Think about it. 2013, I was told, that ain't how it works, kid. You know, is the kid with the data sheet. Oh, come on, kid. And now suddenly it's a total immersion with getting that information and figuring out what makes sense to get it into the field. The other part of that was, Bill DeWitt was a big part of that with the Cardinals and saying eventually, hey, look, this doesn't make sense that we're doing all this work and it's not getting to the field. And he eventually broke up his front office. So, yeah, it, you know, started really there. And then when you get to John Henry, he goes full bore, and now you know the Rays obviously are at the vanguard of all of this, and they're also run by guys who know how data and information work. Yes? Yeah, I think bullpenning. I think a full bullpen attack. Why have a starting pitcher? Why are there starting pitchers? Well, because we used to have one. He was the starter. He was the starter in the end, and the closer and the finisher and everything in between. Why do you start with a guy? Why in the National League do you let a guy, pitch the first two innings and have him bat? Why not have an opener, have a guy pitch two innings, pinch hit for him, and then bring in your Adam Wainwright type, let him go from the third to the eighth? It's just tradition, really. So I think that's the next big thing. There are fewer and fewer of these things, of course. But the other thing, obviously, is, even utilizing your closer. If you have a super reliever, an excellent reliever, why can't he pitch the fifth inning? You know, Billy Martin brought in Sparky Lyle in the fourth inning, in the fifth inning, in playoff games. Now, I know the kind of do-or-die circumstances, but only a few years ago, there were playoff games, do-or-die, one-game, winner-take-all, where Craig Kimbrell didn't get into the game, or Aroldis Chapman didn't get into the game. The two best strikeout pitchers in history didn't get into a game where their teams lost and went out. So I think the next thing, that's an easy thing, is to not worry about saves and let your relief ace roam high leverage and execute. Yes?
So in thinking ahead of the curve, what do you think is the message for parents and teachers in guiding their children about what they should be lessons?
Well, yeah, that is important. I think that's why we can, better living through sabermetrics, that what is the message for kids out there is to have an open mind and realize that our associative memories, the things that pop into our heads on a regular basis, we have very little control over them. It's just like something like a primacy effect, where the first time you see this ball player, he makes a nice running catch. In your head, that guy's a great defender for the next 10 years. No matter what you do, that guy's a great defender. So you need to question your assumptions constantly and think things through. So I think those that you asked about the lessons of, for kids out there, I think, what's more fascinating than learning about the sabermetric revolution in baseball and then how to apply it to the rest of your world, given that baseball is such a great game. Yes? No, announcer. Yeah, I've done boxing for years. I did boxing Friday night fights for ESPN for about 11 years. I did Showtime boxing for 2 years. I'm a host and play-by-play. When I was a young guy, I was up in the Catskill Boxing Club when Mike Tyson was there, Floyd Patterson's.
Done anything recently?
Yeah, I do boxing for Fox Sports now. Yeah, we had a fight in January. We don't have one scheduled yet, but I'll be on Fox when the next one comes up. Yes? Well, you know, I don't know if it's more value, but they are more keenly aware of their own individual value, aren't they? You know, just in this past off season, a lot of stories on guys like Jacob deGrom and Gerrit Cole going, you know, hey, wait, hold on a second. Hold on, wait, I've got to wait how long before I can get paid? And Jose Bautista, you know, now he's, you know, acting in his own self-interest, of course, but he is saying, no, there's ways of measuring this, and I'd like to be paid as such. So I think that's going to be part of it. And I know Joe Sheehan wrote something in his newsletter not too long ago that really kind of crystallized some various thoughts I had, but I never put them all together, that the whole system is built toward wait your turn, service time, you get paid. What happens if the service time is happening for fewer and fewer players? You know, because now if you're a GM, how many big money contracts are you going to be signing for a guy in his 30s? Not many. We can see this happening already. So if that little pot of gold isn't there at the end, then where's the pot of gold? Telling the Jacob deGroms and Gerrit Coles to, hey, wait your turn, everything's going to be fine, you know, that might not pan out. Yes? I guess so. You know, I don't really have knowledge of that, except I hear the same thing you've heard. I hear the same thing from Dan O'Dowd, former Rockies GM who works with us now at MLB Network. He has told that to us numerous occasions, that they're still looking at a lot of these old school numbers. And yeah, you got to get your wins and you got to get saves. I'm thinking, really? Like now in this day and age? I'm incredulous. Yes. Mm-hmm. Well, I think, yeah, we're getting to the point where an open-minded manager, like, say, Clint Hurdle, who finally did the full buy-in and brought his baseball ops people down in the clubhouse with him, so now it's just a regular course of action. Those guys should be walking around like coaches, you know, and they should be just regular conversations where those things can be facilitated. And I think the Pirates are the ones who are doing it. You can see they kind of reverse engineer their pitchers. You know, like, hey, you know what? We need more ground balls. We need fewer ground balls. We need more of this. Why don't we work on this with our coaches and try to devise that? You know, that's where you see real power coming in, and that's part of the Pirates' rise is, as you say, yeah, everybody collaborating, being on the same page. I'm going to do one more question because then we got to wrap up.
What role do you think the development of analytics
has played in parity? Oh, it's huge. He's asking, has it played a role in parity? I don't think there's any question, even from the Pirates, you know, on the rise, the Rays staying competitive. I think that's been a huge part of it. And I bring that up too. When I was at ESPN and it was the heyday of the, you know, Yankees-Red Sox rivalry, we wondered, is this a runaway train that's never coming back? Because there's no salary cap. Why would anybody be able to catch the Yankees, Red Sox, or Phillies? There was really a big three, and then there was a gulf. And, you know, it shows, you know, you learn things. At that, only 10 years ago, we thought this might not ever change. but it did change. And a lot of it was those teams that were at the bottom deciding, all right, we're going to fully invest in player development, knowing that the game is kind of rigged toward us because you have club control over a player those first 6 years. You pay them very little, and that's actually a better way to develop your club. You just need patience. Patience and an owner who's saying, no, we're not investing more, so figure out a new way. And we could see a whole bunch of clubs started doing that. So I think that is part of it. The information revolution started. And if you're winning, you have less incentive to jump to something new. But when you're at the bottom, we learned those teams, Rays, Pirates, A's, they had an incentive, to really embrace this and make the leap. All right, good questions. Thank you, everybody.